You're listening to the audio production of What's Best Next? Audio Lectures by Matt Perman, published by Zondervan and presented by the author. These audio lectures are a unique learning experience. Unlike a traditional audiobook's direct narration of a book's text, What's Best Next includes high-quality live recordings that cover the important points from each chapter, as well as relevant material from other sources.
It's hard to get things done. Most of us have way too much to do and too little time to do it in. As David Allen points out, the process of managing our workflow is often messy and overflows its banks. Behind closed doors, after hours, there remain unanswered calls, tasks to be delegated, unprocessed issues from meetings and conversations, overflowing email, personal responsibilities unmanaged, and dozens of other things not dealt with. And as Scott Belsky notes, while the tendency to generate ideas is rather natural, the path to making them happen is often tumultuous. This impacts us in a lot of ways. We feel stressed out and overloaded at all of the input coming our way. We feel torn between competing demands, as though there is not enough of us to go around. We feel exhausted from always rushing. We feel guilty that we sometimes sacrifice the important for the urgent. We live in an incredibly exciting time in history. Most of us love our jobs and find the world of work exciting. We have more opportunity to do good than ever before, and more opportunity to do creative, challenging work than perhaps at any time in history. Yet, the difficulty and stress we face in getting things done often prevents us from being able to capitalize on this opportunity. Is it possible for the process of getting things done to be less chaotic? Is it possible to feel less stress, less anxiety, and less mental overload? It is possible to get more done in less time with less friction and frustration and more peace of mind. But the path to this is surprising because it involves asking some questions that we often overlook when it comes to time management. We often fail to ask questions like this: what does God think about all of this? More specifically, how should we think about this as Christians? Unfortunately, it can be hard to find the answer to these questions. There is a shortage of teaching in the church on how to get things done, and we are all suffering for it. There are many great secular books which we can benefit much from, but they don't show how all of this connects to God. It is my contention that in addition to the very helpful secular books that exist, we also need to develop a distinctly Christian understanding of how to get things done. We miss something important and amazing if we don't think about productivity from a specifically biblical perspective. And I think the world misses something too. When you think about it, as Christians, we believe that the gospel changes everything. How we go about our home life, our work life, our church life, our community life, everything is changed by the gospel. Yet, there has been little Christian reflection on how the gospel changes the way we get things done. In fact, good productivity practices are often downplayed in the church, as though it is not a spiritual concern. We need to know how to execute, how to get things done, and manage ourselves. Of course, there is a right way and a wrong way to develop a Christian approach to something. Unfortunately, Christians these days often have a reputation for taking the wrong approach. My aim in this series is to reshape the way you think about productivity and then present a practical approach to help you become more effective in your life with less stress and frustration, whatever you are doing. I want to help you live the life that God has called you to live, with maximum effectiveness and meaning wherever you are. I want to give you an overview of where we're going, but first, who am I? I am actually a theologian at heart who has been struggling with the issue of how to get things done ever since seminary. And then I went up after college and I studied under John Piper in Minneapolis and started working at his ministry, Desiring God, where I stayed for about 13 years. If you have heard of Desiring God before, you know that it is a very theologically driven organization. But there's something surprising that I found out when I graduated from seminary and began my first full-time role there. It was that knowing theology was not enough in order to get my job done. Early on, I was given large responsibilities of launching a nationwide radio program and managing the web department while also managing the church and conference bookstores. It was a lot to do, and I found it was hard to stay above water. So I decided to do with productivity the same thing that I did with theology. I did a lot of reading and taking notes, and I developed approaches and systems and tested them out. Now, as I was developing my approach, I actually got some pushback from some people, from some spiritual leaders who questioned whether it really was necessarily spiritual to focus on these things. Now, they came to understand the spiritual importance of these matters, but I also thought it was important for me to ask what was behind their initial pushback about learning about these things. The ultimate thing they were trying to say is, don't leave the scriptures and the gospel behind in how you think about productivity. You need to think about productivity on a biblical foundation using all the theological knowledge that you have learned. What the church needs is someone who brings those two things together. The result of my quest is what I call gospel-driven productivity. That's just a fancy name for what the Bible has always taught. Gospel-driven productivity, which we can also call GDP, is centered on what the Bible has to say about getting things done, while at the same time learning from the best secular thinking out there. Seeking to do this with excellence and original thought, rather than simply taking over secular ideas and adding out-of-context Bible verses. The essence of gospel-driven productivity is this. We are to use all that we have, including our productivity strategies, for the good of others to the glory of God, and that this is the most exciting and fulfilling life. To be a gospel-driven Christian means to be on the lookout to do good for others to the glory of God in all areas of life, and to use productivity strategies and practices to do this with creativity and competence. That's what it means to be gospel-driven in our productivity. Here's an overview of what we will be learning. First, we're going to look at why we need to begin with God in our productivity. That's part one. It shows us why it's so hard to get things done, why the typical answers of efficiency don't work, and how the only way to be ultimately productive is to live our lives for God. Part two looks at the guiding principles for living a productive life. What happens when we do look at productivity in light of God and the gospel? That's what we will see in this section, which shows how the gospel radically changes the way we get things done altogether. It changes our purpose, our manner, our motives, and our foundations. It enables us to get not just the right things done, but to get them done in the right way and for the right reason. Parts 3 through 6 are the practical heart of gospel-driven productivity. They give us the process for being gospel-driven in our productivity. We will see that there are 4 steps to leading and managing ourselves for effectiveness. They are define, architect, reduce, and execute. Define. This means knowing your mission, vision, roles, and goals. This is not just a matter of clarifying your vision and values. It is a matter of identifying what the right vision and values to have are in the first place, and then basing our lives, our entire lives, on them. What's crucial here is to value the things that God values and to look to His Word to understand what they are. Then the step of architect means once you've identified the most important principles and goals, you have to weave these things into the structure of your life through a basic schedule or time map, because intentions are not enough. A bad or non-existing structure to your life will undo the best of intentions. As Andy Stanley has said, systems trump intentions. One of the biggest reasons we have these great intentions that sometimes never get done is because we do not weave them into our lives through a coherent system. Then the third step of the DARE model is reduce. After architecting your life and schedule, the biggest obstacle that you will often find is that you have a hard time making everything fit. This doesn't necessarily mean that you've architected wrong. Rather, it just means you need to reduce. You need to know what's most important. That's the define step. Weave it into your life. That's the architect step. And then get rid of the rest. That's the reduce step. This brings us into the realm of the core practices of your day-to-day time management, including delegating, eliminating, automating, and deferring, as well as how to turn time killers back on themselves by harnessing them rather than being distracted by them. Then the fourth step of the DARE process is execute. This is the stage of making things happen in the moment. It is easy to think of execution as synonymous with productivity, when in fact, as you'll notice here, it is really just one step, the last step. When you have things defined, architected, and reduced, the path is cleared up for efficient and enjoyable execution. Now, conveniently, as I've pointed out, these four steps form the acronym DARE, which thus also reminds us of the all-important guiding principle that underlies all of this, which is that we should have a sense of adventure in doing good. That is, we should be radical and risky and creative and abundant in using our effectiveness to make life better for others, and that this is the most exciting life. What is the result of all of this? That is the last section in our series. We will see that we need to understand productivity not simply in the sense of personal productivity, but also in a broader sense. Seeing productivity as about managing our organizations, leading our cities and societies, and making them more productive as well. Most of all, we will look at what the Bible teaches about the results of gospel-driven productivity in the world. We will see that as we are productive in a gospel-centered way, God renews our workplaces, communities, cities, and the entire world for the advance of the gospel and the common good. The result is the transformation of the world. As Martin Lloyd-Jones said, if only every Christian in the church today were living the Sermon on the Mount, which is the anchor of gospel-driven productivity, the great revival for which we are praying and longing would already have started. Do you understand productivity in the right way? We're going to look at a new understanding of how to get things done, and beyond that, what it even means to get things done. The things that we will see are supported by the best research and the scriptures, but many of them may be new to you. To give you a feel for this right from the start, let's begin by busting 10 myths about what it means to get things done. Myth one, productivity is about getting more done faster. When most people think of productivity, they think of efficiency, getting more things done faster. While efficiency is important, it is actually secondary. More important than efficiency is effectiveness, getting the right things done. Efficiency doesn't matter if you're doing the wrong things in the first place. Myth number two, the way to be productive is to have the right techniques and tools. Using great tools and the most helpful techniques is a lot of fun, but like efficiency, it is secondary. We are going to learn the most helpful methods.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.